Welcome to Wednesday's edition of Renew Plus. I'm Pastor Tony. Thank you for joining us again today, midweek, week number 9 of our Access Road on Grace. And I tell you, we're getting into some of the depths of what grace has done for us in Christ. And I tell you, some of these things that we're talking about in Romans, particularly Romans 6, the statements that Paul makes, you're going to say, where in the world is he coming from? He's gotten left field somewhere. Well, he's not. We're in left field. We're still thinking in religious terms, having that religious running system of self-righteousness in our own heart. But once we begin to see things through the eyes of grace, which is through the eyes of God, that this is all a reality, redemption was accomplished as a work, a finished work in Christ from God to man, not from us to God. And see, once you begin to have your heart established in grace, have that running system of grace we're talking about, then some of these things begin to make sense to us. So in Romans 5, as we read, Romans 5, he's making some powerful statements about what the grace of God did in Christ and how much greater the grace of God is and how it superabounded and surpassed sin and the fall of man and condition that we were in the first Adam in sin. And then he goes over into chapter 6, and that's where we want to start again today. Romans chapter 6, verse 1, it says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Now, he's preemptively asking and answering a question he knows is going to come up after what he just said in chapter 5, with some of the things we read. You know, they're going to come to the conclusion and really scoff and mock and be sarcastic and say, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? In other words, they think that's what Paul's saying in all this, and that's not what Paul is saying. Because grace creates a reality in our life that is beyond and apart from and out from under the dominion of sin. Now notice right here, he answers this question in verse 2. He says, certainly not. In other words, unequivocally, that is not what Paul's saying, that's not what I'm saying, that's not what people who actually preach the true gospel of grace are saying. It says, certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Well, when did we die to sin? Well, when we were in Christ, just like Paul said, I was crucified with him, yet nevertheless I live. Paul saw himself being crucified on that cross with Jesus. Jesus was taking our place. And one translation says, Jesus took us to the cross with him and there died. That old man died. That old sinner man died. That old man under sin, condemnation, guilt, and shame that came from that first Adam. We all inherited from the first Adam. He died. There was an end to him on that cross with Jesus. So he says, how shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? In other words, we shouldn't be living under sin anymore, under its effects, under its dominion over our life anymore. Why? Because the greater reality of grace is that we already died and were crucified with Jesus on the cross. So he goes on in verse number 3 and says, or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? And we said yesterday that we're baptized means to plunge or be immersed into. We were completely immersed into Jesus in his identity. I tell you, that's why these realities are ours today. Everything that Jesus did for us, we did with him. So he says that we were baptized, immersed, plunged into Christ Jesus. We were baptized, plunged into his death, into his crucifixion. That was the end of the sinner man. He says in verse 4, therefore we were buried with him through baptism, immersion, plunging into. We were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should also walk in newness of life. Just as we were crucified with him, just as we were buried with him, we were also raised up, resurrected with him. See, his resurrection now becomes my resurrection. That's why Ephesians 1 says that the same immeasurable, unlimited, and surpassing greatness of God's resurrection power that he exerted and released in Jesus when he raised him from the dead was also working in and for us who believe. See, because Jesus didn't go through all that for himself. He did it for us. He took us to the cross with him. He took us to the tomb with him. And he also took us in resurrected state resurrected by the glory of the Father to walk in this newness of life that we're talking about. See, the grace of God opens up for all of us believers a newness of life that we didn't have before, a new reality in our life that we didn't have before. We're not just a changed person. We are a completely different person in Christ. That's what he's saying. He's describing to us the end of the old man and the beginning of a new man in Christ right here. Verse 5, he said, "For if we have been united together," notice we're together with Christ, "if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection." See, all that grace that he was talking about over in grace statements he was making in Romans 5 that we read, notice this is what grace created right here. Grace created this reality in Christ Jesus right here. You're not the same person you used to be. You're a new man, a new person, a new woman in Christ Jesus, a new creation. You're to walk in newness of life. You're now a resurrected person. You're no longer under that sin condition. You're no longer under condemnation, no longer under guilt and shame from the old person. Now you have a brand new righteousness in Christ. You have a right standing with God that equals Jesus. You have a life that equals Jesus. Everything that God did and put in Christ, he also did and put in us. So he says, "We've been united together in the likeness of his death. Certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection." Verse 6, knowing this. These are things we're supposed to know. We're supposed to know these things right here and walk in them. He says, "Knowing this, that our old man," there it is, "that old man was crucified with him." Same statement from Galatians 2:20. He said, "Our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin." See, if we're yielding to sin today as believers, and we do and we have, we understand that. Sin is not coming from the inside out. Sin is coming from the outside in. It's no longer in our heart and in our nature anymore. That is completely changed. And we have a new life, a new reality, because of the grace of God and the finished work of Jesus. So that sin is not coming from the nature on the inside of us out. It's coming from the outside in. That's why you feel so bad when you do yield your body to sin. When you do commit a sin, and you do commit an act of sin outwardly. Why? Because you've got something going on, a conflict going on, because what's on the inside of you is completely a different nature than what you just yielded to. And see, under pressure, under temptation, under wrong thinking, under not knowing these realities, many times we do yield to sin in our life. But thank God, the blood of Jesus continually cleanses us from all sin. So we can still come into the presence of God with confidence and boldness and full assurance of faith. So verse 7 goes on to say, "For he who has died to sin," or "he who has died has been freed from sin." Well, is that true? Now, a lot of people think this way, they read it this way, "For he who has died physically and gone to heaven is free from sin." That's not the context of what he's talking about right here. He's talking about we who died to sin were crucified with Jesus. We're free from sin now. We're not going to be any more free from sin 10,000 years from now in heaven than we are right now in our spirits. God did not create a sinner new creation. He created a free new creation, a free new person in Christ. So notice that we're already free from sin because we've died to it. Past tense accomplishment, present day reality in Christ Jesus. See, when you begin to walk in the light of this, knowing this, and beginning to walk in the light of this reality that we're talking about right here, this gives you an enablement and an empowerment to not yield to sin, to not go under the dominion of sin anymore, and under its condemnation, certainly, that it is also included in that. With that in mind, let's go over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 real quick. 2 Corinthians 5 and see what I'm talking about right here. And again, we could spend lots of time, and we will in an upcoming series we're going to do down the road on our identification in Christ. But notice right here in verse number 17, 2 Corinthians 5:17. These will become familiar in that series, I can tell you. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, well, how do you become in Christ? By making him the Lord and Savior of your life, confessing him as Lord, believing that God raised him from the dead, and trusting in his finished work. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is, present tense, not going to be, not trying to be, not someday going to be, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. What are the old things that passed away? The old man under the sin condition, the old man under condemnation, guilt and shame, the old man who is imprisoned, incarcerated in Satan's prison house under that condemning sentence, that old man under the curse, that old man under the dominion of sin, that old man, you know, that was sick and poverty-stricken and all those things. Notice, all those things passed away. All those things passed away. And notice, behold, all things have become new. What? All things. All things. All things have become new. That's that newness of life that we talked about. That's that new reality that grace has created for us. It says in verse 18, now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. Who reconciled? Did we do this? Did we earn this reconciliation? No, God did this in Christ. He reconciled us to himself. Reconcile means to be brought back into a right relationship with. So he said he reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation, not condemnation, reconciliation. Verse 19, that is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. The Amplified says in verse 19, very good verse, very good translation in the Amplified, verse 19, it says, it was God personally present in Christ, reconciling and restoring the world to favor with himself, not counting up and holding against men their trespasses, but canceling them. I love that right there. But canceling them and committing to us the message of reconciliation, of restoration to favor. Notice that this is a work of God, meaning it's a work of grace, not something that we do, not something that we earn. It's all a work of God, meaning it is a work of grace freely given to us, made available to us in Christ. But I want you to notice right there, that is completely different than a lot of people think, that God was in Christ canceling sin, not counting up and holding against sin, sins against men's account, not counting those things up and putting those in that sin debt anymore, but canceling them, paying that thing off once and for all. Now, verse 20 goes on to say, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. In other words, God's made reconciliation, restoration of favor to himself, canceling sin, canceling condemnation, clearing out our account of sin. Notice he's already done this, and he's telling us to accept this right now. God's already finished this, but he's telling us to accept this work of grace by our faith and begin to walk in the reality of it right now. So stop walking like you're an old, unworthy sinner, like nothing changed. Even as born-again believers, sometimes people just kind of walk in this life waiting till they get to heaven for everything to change. No, everything changed the moment you made Jesus the Lord of your life. Now, if you're looking in your flesh, if you're looking in your emotions, if you're looking externally around us in this earth, you still see evidence of the fallen nature. But listen, that's not the real us. The real us is our spirit. The real us is the new creation that God has done in Christ and already done. It's already a done deal. He's already made us new creations in Christ, in our spirits. And see, when you're looking at things through grace, you see a new man, you see a new woman, you see a new person in Christ, not that old sinner man under condemnation. And he's telling you, come and be reconciled to God. Accept this grace of reconciliation. And then in verse 21, he says, for he made him who knew no sin. That's God the Father made Jesus who knew no sin to be sin for us, when? On the cross. So notice, that we might be made or become the righteousness of God in Him. There's that great exchange of grace that we've been talking about. Jesus absorbing our condition so that we could take His condition. Jesus becoming what we were so that we could become what He is by faith. Again, all of these are realities. This is what Paul's talking about right here. He said, you know, we don't continue to live in sin because we already died to it. We're already new creations. We're already the righteousness of God in Christ. We're already reconciled to God. And this is not a work in progress. This is not something we're trying to do. This is something that God's already done, finished, completed in Christ, and then given to us as a free gift by grace. Man, that's awesome right there. I'm talking as fast as I can. I know we said a lot of stuff today, but I believe we're getting the gist of it. Amen. Well, that's all the time I've got for today. If you'd like additional materials, go to tonycowan.org. We'll see you tomorrow.